Good morning and welcome to First Christian Church Disciples of Christ on this Sunday, April 19th, 2020.
I'll be reading 1 Peter 1, 3-8. Praise be to God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In His great mercy, He has given us new birth into the living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead and into inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. This inheritance is kept in heaven for you, who through faith is shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time. In all this, you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while you may have had to suffer grief in all kinds of trials. These have come so that the proven geniuses of your faith, of greater worth than gold, which perishes even though refined by fire, may result in praise, glory, and honor of Jesus Christ when revealed. Though you have not seen Him, you love Him, and even though you have not seen Him now, you believe in Him, and are filled with inexpressible and glorious joy.
Let us now go to God in prayer. Holy and Almighty God, we thank You, despite the difficulty of the circumstances in which we now find ourselves, we thank You for bringing us all together to worship and to praise You. We ask in this time where we are worshiping in separate locations that we be united in spirit. We ask that You would unite us by the movement of Your love among us, and that You would open our eyes, ears, hearts, and minds in this moment as we receive Your word. We ask, O God, that our very souls would become fertile soil for the planting of Your word within us. And we ask that that word would grow and bear good fruit for the kingdom of God. And may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in Thy sight, O Lord, our Rock and our Redeemer. Amen. So, this is the 16th time that I've recorded this sermon. Now, of all those 16 times, I might have gotten a few minutes in and then had to cut it and go and start all over again. Not all of those 16 times were a great ordeal for me. It happens often when I'm preparing a sermon that I start and stop and start and stop. That's not a big deal. But actually, this week, I have recorded successfully the entire sermon, and for one reason or another, had to go back and re-record it again, which was very frustrating. In fact, I came in today, today's Saturday that I'm recording this, and I recorded what I thought was the best version yet. And actually, I did it out there in that courtyard. I did all of the prayers of the people, the invocation. I did the welcome to the church, the invocation. I did all of this stuff outside. It was a beautiful day. It looked great. It went great. There were no stumblings and all of that. And I went and I tried to put it into my computer, and there were major technical errors. And so I had to find myself using other footage that had already been recorded that was not my favorite to date, and then having to re-record now the sermon so that I can put it all together for a coherent worship service. Now, I have to admit, I'm still in the moment in a little bit of frustration over all of this, but I'm hoping that by the time you're watching this, of course, the Spirit of God's power and peace has washed over me, and that this is becoming a worship service that is meaningful to you. That is my hope and my prayer. And if not, then well, we'll just try again next week. So anyway, I got to say all that so that I can get comfortable to preach this word. I have to get back into that frame of mind where I can relinquish myself and my ego and allow God's Spirit to do with me what God will. So I'd like to draw your attention to this text. Okay, we just heard from 1 Peter. 1 Peter comes from the New Testament section of letters. So 1 Peter is among the many documents of the New Testament that are called epistolary literature. An epistle is just that's a fancy word for a letter or a correspondence, and that's where you would find 1 Peter. And I'm excited to preach it. In fact, I'm doing a series on 1 Peter beginning today, going through the next 5 weeks after today for the season of Easter, because after all, Easter is a season, not a day that goes all the way up until Pentecost. And I'm excited to do this because when I decided to do it, which was months ago before any of this stuff happened, I knew that I had not had an opportunity to study Peter like I would have to do sermon series, and I haven't been able to preach on Peter very often in the past. So to preach from this is a blessing to me, and I hope it becomes a blessing to you. Now, after the pandemic started and our new way of living and worshiping is suddenly upon us, I looked at the letter of 1 Peter, and it was amazing. It was almost as if this letter was custom written for the situation that we're in right now. All right, so the situation that we're in right now and the situation that provides the context in which 1 Peter was written is similar in a certain way. So the letter of 1 Peter is written to a group of churches who are suffering. They're suffering persecution. In fact, the letter is all about suffering, or at least our response to and God's place in suffering. Now, this is a bit of a complicated concept, which is why I've had to record and re-record these sermons over and over again, trying to find a way to say this in a plain way that makes sense. But I believe that suffering kind of happens predominantly, there might be more things going on, but that suffering predominantly happens kind of in two different levels. So there's the suffering that comes by the actions of something happening on the outside of us, right? So for the people in the ancient world, the people who were first reading this letter of Peter that was being circulated among them, they were experiencing a suffering that was coming from the outside. And that suffering was called persecution. They were being persecuted by the Roman Empire. The Roman Empire didn't like the church. They considered the church a threat. The surrounding culture was not very hospitable to the church at the time. These were Gentile churches who were very much out of place in a Gentile world that surrounded them. And they experienced persecution. They experienced isolation and abandonment from the people around them. And that in itself is suffering. I'm sure that they struggled to survive. They struggled to find ways to provide for themselves in a hostile surrounding culture. And in that way, they suffered. There were times in which these churches would be persecuted and that people would be arrested. They would be condemned and they would be executed. And that, of course, is a form of suffering that we know as persecution. It's a suffering that comes from the outside. However, there is another kind of suffering that runs in parallel to that kind of suffering that I just described. And it's not the suffering that comes from the outside, it's the suffering within. Okay? So you can imagine that the people living in the world that 1 Peter is addressed to, that these people would not only be experiencing the persecution from the outside, which is its own kind of suffering, but rather they would also be experiencing an internal situation which would qualify as suffering that you could call fear or anxiety or despondency, despair, or anger and frustration. There's an internal situation which is not unconnected from the external situation that these people would have been suffering. So they know that the Roman Empire doesn't like them. They can see the ways in which the Roman Empire can hurt them. And that in itself will create another form of suffering, which is the fear and the anxiety, the anger, the despair that could be precipitated or triggered by that external circumstance. I hope that makes sense, right? External, internal. Now, that's important because there's a place I believe that we in the 21st century in our situation can connect with this text. And it's not in the external suffering part of it, right? Because the church in our day and age is not persecuted. Now, I feel like I shouldn't even have to say this, but it baffles me that people actually believe that we are persecuted in the United States of America. Now, maybe there are times in which we experience the discomfort that comes from living as Christian people in a culture that's not always hospitable to Christianity, that has values rather that run in a different direction than our values, okay? But that's not persecution. Persecution is when people have their lives threatened. Persecution happens when people actually die. And if you want to know what that looks like, you can talk to some missionaries who have taken the gospel into Africa or Asia or certain areas of the country where it's very hostile towards Christianity, where there are laws put in place where the penalty is death if you're caught living in a church. That is persecution. So suffice it to say, the place that we do not connect with this text is in the idea of persecution. I have to clarify that point. The place that I think we do connect to this text is in our internal circumstance, our internal suffering, right? So we're in an experience right now where there's a pandemic going on, and because there's a pandemic going on, there's all kinds of external circumstances that look like this. There's a virus, and if this virus infects you, there's a possibility, not a certainty, but a possibility that you could become very sick. And then if you're somebody who becomes very sick, there's a possibility, not a certainty, but there's a possibility that you could die. And that is a suffering in and of itself. Okay? There's a possibility that someone that you love could become sick and die. And that would create a pain that also counts as suffering, to have somebody that you love be taken away from you. There are people who are being overworked and under-resourced in the midst of this pandemic. There are certain areas of the country where there are nurses and doctors who are not properly resourced or haven't been properly resourced, and they are suffering in that way by an overwhelming workload in the midst of a very serious crisis. And there are people who have lost their job. This is an enormous source of suffering. There's an economic situation where entire industries have been shut down and livelihoods have been put on hold, and that means that there are people that are having difficulty making ends meet, providing for their families, getting enough food in order to survive, pay their rent, get the necessities that you need, such as medicine to live. That is a suffering that we are enduring. But where we connect to the text, I think, is the idea that we also suffer on the inside in the midst of all of that. So as that stuff is going on, we are also living, some of us at least, probably most of us, in a little bit of fear, right? In a little bit of anxiety, in a little bit of frustration or anger, or maybe even some despair. We have an internal situation that we are feeling in the midst of an external situation. That's where we connect. Now, why am I going to great lengths to make this particular point? Well, the reason is because I believe human beings are the kind of creature that experience suffering on the inside, and we want to alleviate that suffering. And the way that we do it is we try to control the external situations. So me and you and everyone else, we believe that if we can somehow get the world to do the right thing, enact right policy, open up at the right time, not too soon but not too late, and not over here necessarily before we do this over here, that if we can get the world to behave right and do the right thing, if we can fix, manage, and control the external situation, then we can feel okay on the inside. Now, when we look at the letter of 1 Peter, it's very interesting, and I wouldn't have even noticed this if I hadn't been forced in this particular frame of mind given our circumstances. But I'm reading 1 Peter, and 1 Peter is talking all about the suffering, the persecution, the situation that these people are going through. And never does he say, okay, this is what you should do. You should control that external situation. It never says that you should put together a council of people and you should go to the Roman Empire and you should negotiate with them and you should try to get them to concede to some of your demands and you concede to some of their demands and you work out a solution and all of a sudden the persecution will go away. There's never a moment in that text in which the advice that is given, the direction it is given, is to do certain things in order to end the suffering that they are enduring, to end the persecution. And I thought that was interesting. In fact, if you look through all the New Testament letters that are not 1 Peter, where there are situations of suffering, and there often is, there's never advice to do that particular thing, to try to end the suffering on the outside. In fact, if you go through the entire Bible, the phenomenon of suffering is never responded to with direction from God or a prophet or anyone else to do certain things to end that kind of persecution or external suffering. And that's important for us to see because I think that's what we try to do. I'll tell you what that looks like for me, okay? So I'm one of these people that believes that if we can cooperate as a people, that if we can put our differences aside, not pretend they don't exist, but just put them aside, and approach a table of trust and mutuality. If people could come together, sit down at that table, and look at this complex and complicated and consequential problem that we face, that because we come in the spirit of unity and bring our diversity of viewpoint and opinion, and bring all of our creativity to bear on the situation, that we can, history tells us, come up with solutions that will be comprehensive and that might be full of compromises that leave not one person completely satisfied, but might come up with a solution that over a long sweep of time ends up preserving our most cherished values. That if we do that, then things will be okay. And I believe that. I believe that if we're going to get through this, that's how we're going to get through it. But here's the thing. I'm trying to control what's happening outside of me. In other words, all the people that won't get along, all the people that are fighting on Facebook and yelling at each other through the media and refusing to talk to one another, I'm trying to control all of them to get them to behave, to fix the problem, which I say is a good idea. But in actuality, I don't really do this to fix the problem. I do this to fix myself. Do you see that? I'm just trying to end that internal suffering, that internal agony, the anxiety, the fear, the frustration, and so forth. I don't sleep well at night, and I want to sleep well at night. And I feel like I can sleep well at night if I can get other people to do the right thing. And the way I get other people to do the right thing is to tell them what it is they're supposed to do. And here's the problem. It doesn't work. It doesn't work. I have no power over other people. And secondly, it's not even necessary. Okay, so come with me in 1 Peter. Peter doesn't tell them to address the suffering of the world by trying to end the persecution. They just assume that the persecution is going to continue. And do you want to know why? Because they know something we don't. Ancient people see something that we have become blind to. They know that life is full of suffering. That's just the way it is. That external stuff, we have such little control over it, and no matter how hard we try to control it, there will always be a persecution of one sort or another. There will always be some type of suffering that is going to come from the outside, unforeseen events, people that aren't acting right. There will be the winds of change that blow over a civilization that will bring things we can't imagine. There's no end to suffering. But we in the modern world, we have fallen for this illusion that somehow if we do the right thing, that we can get through life without feeling any pain. I see parents operating under this assumption. They try to arrange the life of their children in such a way that their children never, ever feel pain or ever suffer. Now, of course, we should protect our children. I would never contradict that truism. But by God, I have to show you that if we successfully protect them from enduring any kind of pain or suffering their entire life, any kind of disappointment, well, then we're setting them up for the worst suffering of all, which is to go into the great big wide world with no tools, no experience whatsoever to deal with the inevitabilities of life. And we allow people to come into our churches and we allow them to believe that if they do the right thing and they believe the right thing and they confess the right confessions and creeds and come and worship the right way, that somehow they will get through life with less suffering or no suffering. And that's just wrong. There's nothing in our scriptures that tell us that that's true. In fact, being a disciple oftentimes will bring more suffering and discomfort upon you. That's just the way that it is. So Peter addresses something different. Peter addresses that internal situation, and this is how he does it. He tells them that you need to remember who you are. He says it this way. You have been given a new life and a new hope that comes through the resurrection of Jesus. In other words, you have a new perspective. You have a new life. You have a new way of seeing the world. You have a new experience that comes through that experience that Christ has being resurrected from the grave. God acts in Jesus and allows all the evil of the world, all the suffering of the world to bear down upon him, and it kills him, but he is resurrected. And that resurrection is a power. It's an intervention of God's power into the world, this intervention intervention of the power of love into our world and circumstance that allows us to be reborn, that gives us a new hope and new eyes to see things in a new way. And what it shows us is who we really are. Now, this is how Peter says it. He says that you have an inheritance, and that inheritance is waiting for you in heaven. That inheritance is imperishable, can't be destroyed. It is undefiled, meaning that it can't be perverted or polluted. And it is unfading, meaning it has the same value yesterday as today as tomorrow. There's no inflation that can debase the value of this particular currency in your inheritance. And that inheritance is union with God. That inheritance is the answer to every problem, question, mystery, or suffering that you could possibly have. That inheritance is permanent and eternal unity with your Creator forever and ever, from the top of your head to the depths of your soul. That is your inheritance. And if it's your inheritance, then what does that mean? Well, an inheritance comes from the one who begets you. The inheritance comes from the one who gives birth to you. The inheritance comes to the one from the one to whom you belong. You get an inheritance from your parents or your grandparents. So what this text is saying is that you have an inheritance waiting for you in heaven that comes from God, i.e., you belong to God, i.e., you are a child of God. That's who gets inheritances. You are a child of God, and because of that, you should know that there's no reason to try to fix the inside of yourself by fixing the rest of the world. Number one, if God is God, then God's got that under control. I think that I know what the world should do. I think that I know that the world needs to be united for everyone to get along, for us to have solutions. I think that I know these things, and when I piece it all together, sure seems right to me, but I don't know. When it comes down to it, these are questions that only God can answer. God has the world under control. God has this pandemic in His hand. God is the one that will deliver us from any suffering that we endure, any persecution that a church might undergo. God has it under control. I got no business messing around with that. And if I am a child of God, then that means there's no reason to fix me by fixing that, because there's nothing fundamentally that needs fixing. I'm a human being. I make mistakes. That's a given. I sin and I repent, and I sin again and I repent again. But there is no lack of value within me. There's nothing ultimately that I need to do to bring peace, because peace comes from me recognizing the truth. I have worth and value, not by virtue of anything that I've done or anything that I will do, but rather by being created by the hand of the Master. That's where I get my worth. That's why there's no reason for me to fix the world to fix me. That's why the course of action for me to take is to trust that that inheritance is real, and therefore I can live in such a way where I can find peace. In the middle of the storm, I can find peace. In the middle of chaos, I can find peace. In the middle of violence, I can find peace. In the middle of a global pandemic, I can find peace. That's what it means to be a child of God, to have an inheritance waiting for you, which is eternal union with God. The way the text goes on, it says that we are protected by the power of God through our faith. What is faith? Faith is just living as though everything that I said is true. I won't go too far into it because I don't want to confuse or lose anybody, and that's why I've had to record this thing 15 or 16 times. Okay, here it is. Live in such a way as though what I just said is true about you being a child of God. If you believe that, then you would live in a way filled with love. If you believe that, you would live in a way filled with humility and compassion. If you believe that, you would live in such a way where you would not operate in the world to get people to behave a certain way to fix yourself, but rather you would operate in a world knowing that as a child of God, you have something to contribute. You have some peace to give. You have some love to give. You have some joy to distribute to those who are crying. You have good news to proclaim. Live in such a way, and that is the faith in and of itself, that trusting faith that connects you to God, and that power that comes from God shall protect you in the midst of all of this. That's what Peter says to those who are suffering persecution we can't even imagine. And here's the beautiful thing that happens as a result of that. This is the last part of the sermon I promise. And if I haven't left you behind somewhere along the way, then come along a little bit further because you're really going to love this. All right. So what happens is that suffering becomes transformed. When we know who we are and we know that there's nothing I can do to control the world to make me feel any better, and that all that I need to do is live in such a way, which is called faith, which acts out that trusting belief that everything that I just said is true. When I live in such a way, I'm protected by the power of God no matter what I'm going through, and that suffering becomes transformed. Now, when I say that suffering becomes transformed, I don't mean that we're just making lemonade out of lemons, right? I don't mean that we're finding a silver lining on a deep, dark, black cloud, okay? I don't mean that we're looking on the bright side, that suffering has become transformed. What I mean is that suffering has become transformed. Okay, so let me give you an example. The cross. We all know the cross. I'm going to give you an example of suffering being transformed. Okay, so the cross, we remember, was a terrible, terrifying thing. Now, you might not even know that, but just stop for a few minutes and think about it. The cross was a place where the Roman Empire crucified people who tried to go up against Roman power. It was a place where they executed dissenters. The cross was used to kill people. It was a symbol of horror. It was a symbol of terror because it wasn't the cheapest way to kill people. It wasn't the fastest way to kill people, not even the most convenient way to kill people, not even for the Romans. The reason they crucified people on a cross is because it was public, it was humiliating, and it was excruciating. And when people would see the cross and they would see someone hanging on it, they would be filled with fear and terror that would keep them in their place. That was the point. And even when there was no one on the cross, when you just saw an empty cross, you would still be filled with terror as you remembered what happened to your father or your brother or your son or your uncle or somebody else who dared up to go against power. Okay, you understand that. But Jesus goes to that cross and transforms it into something else. Not just something else, into its opposite. Jesus takes the suffering of the cross and transforms it into an emblem of my salvation. Jesus takes that suffering, and by going to the cross, he doesn't erase the cross, he doesn't abolish the cross, he doesn't bury the cross, he doesn't vanquish the cross from our memories, he doesn't take the cross out of our human existence, he leaves it right where it is because the cross is reality. Suffering is reality, but going to it, he transforms it into its opposite, now into a symbol that I look at with hope, with inspiration, with faith, and with the knowledge of who I belong to, not who I should be cowering before. Does that make sense? Well, that's what's happening in this text when he says that the suffering you're going through, it's about to be transformed now, the suffering that you're going through is testing your faith. That faith is more valuable than gold. That's what it says in the text. That faith, even though it's perishable, is more valuable than anything you can imagine. But that suffering that you're going to is a testing as if by fire that will make that faith stronger. You see, the meaning of suffering is supposed to be to weaken your faith, to beat you down, to tell you to let go of your hope. But that's not what this suffering can do when placed in God's hands. It can become this mechanism, this instrument that actually strengthens your faith. That's what Peter says. So just take suffering as a given. And know that there's nothing you need to do to make yourself feel better, to make yourself exist better by trying to control it. Just accept it and rejoice because you're going to suffer anyway. So let's suffer by being children of God. Let's suffer by doing the right thing. Let's suffer by remembering our inheritance. And in the process, the suffering itself becomes something that strengthens us, that hardens us, that makes it possible for us not only to get through this, but anything else that will come on down the road. That's my sermon. That's what I've tried to preach 16 times. And for some reason, it's only until now that I'm getting an opportunity to do it, hopefully in a way that is being recorded that you can watch tomorrow. But I got to tell you that I'm filled with good news. I got to tell you that sometimes I don't even want to be filled with good news. I just want to wallow in the despair and the anxiety that I feel. But you know what? When I read that text, and I see what it says, and I believe it, and I live as though what I believe is true, then I'm able to see things around me I never saw before. And even though this is a dark period that we are in, and there's potentially even a darker period coming, that things might get worse before they get better, or they might get worse before they get even worse. I don't know. But what I do know is that nothing can suppress our hallelujah. Nothing in this Easter season can suppress our joy. Nothing can keep us from shouting, rejoice, hallelujah. The news is good that Christ has been resurrected, and that I am a child of the King, that we shall have our inheritance in heaven, and that until we get there, we shall endure with grace, shining the light of God's love into a dark and hurting world every step of the way. Amen. Receive now the benediction of God. Gracious and holy God, we ask that you would send us now in peace out into your world with good news on our lips and love in our heart to love and to serve you. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen.